endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Guitar. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue. From generation to generation,
we worship you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are.
We
worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you.
You are good,
cause you are good all the time, all the time. Lord, you are good, you are good all the time, all the time. Lord, you are good,
Lord, you are good,
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue. From generation to generation,
we worship you.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are.
We worship you, God.
We worship you. Hallelujah. You are good all the time, all the time. Lord, you are good, you are good all the time, all the time. Lord, you are good.
Give the Lord a praise. Lord, we just worship you with all our heart. With everything we have, God, we give you praise and glory and honor.
I want to scream it out from every mountain top. Your goodness knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me.
I sing because you are good, and I'll dance because you are good, and I'll shout because you are good.
You are good to me.
And I'll sing because you are good, and I'll dance because you are good, and I'll shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Nothing and no one comes anywhere close to you. The earth and ocean sea only reflect this truth. And in my darkest night, you shine as bright as day. Your love amazes me.
Cause I'll sing.
Because you are good, and I'll dance. Because you are good, and I'll shout. Because you are good, you are good.
And I'll sing,
and I'll sing. Because you are good, and I'll dance. Because you are good, and I'll shout. Because you are good, you are good to me.
And with the cry of praise, my heart will proclaim that you are good. You are good. And in the sun or rain, my life celebrates that you are good. You are good.
With a cry of praise,
and with a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim that you are good. You are good.
In the sun or rain,
in the sun.
I'll sing because you are good, and I'll dance because you are good, and I'll shout because you are good. You are good.
And I'll sing.
And I'll sing because you are good, and I'll dance because you are good, and I'll shout because you are good. You are good.
To the Lord and celebrate His goodness. God, we worship you. You are worthy of praise and glory, God. You are worthy of honor. We lift our voices to you in praise and glory, God.
Because I'll sing because you are good, and I'll dance because you are good, and I'll shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Give the Lord a praise, God. Lord, we just worship you with all that we are. We give you praise and glory, God. We just ask you to let your will be done in this place today. Let your will be done in this place, God. Now's the time we take a moment to be the body of Christ, to pray with one another, to bear one another's burdens. And the elders of the church are going to come forward. Be available to pray with you. If you need to be pray, if you need somebody to pray with, if you need somebody to believe with, we just, as we sing these next few songs, now's the time to find somebody, find one of the elders that are up here and seek them out and pray with them.
Because there is power in the name of Jesus. So much power in the name of Jesus. And there is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There's power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power.
So much power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Oh, this power. Power in your name, God.
Cause there is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power.
So much power
in the name of Jesus. There is power.
There is power.
Oh, God.
In the name of Jesus.
Your will be done, your kingdom come.
Break every chain,
break
every chain,
break.
every chain. Break every chain.
Break every chain. Come on.
Break every chain. Break every chain.
Break every chain.
So break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
Oh. Every chain. Every chain of selfishness. Every chain of pride. Every chain of sexual perversion. Every chain of drug addiction. Every chain of alcoholism. Every chain. We give it all to you, God. You're the only one that can fix it. There's no one like you, God. No one like you, God. And your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain. Yes, your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain. Yes, your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain. So break our chains. Break our chains.
Your love.
Your love overcame the grave. Surely you could break every chain. Yes, your love overcame the grave. Surely you could break every chain.
Your
love overcame the grave. Surely you could break every chain. So break our chains. Break our chains. Break our chains. Break our chains.
There is power.
And there is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power.
So much power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
And there is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain,
break every chain, God.
Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Have your way, Jesus.
Break every chain,
have your way, Jesus.
Break every chain.
Have your
break
way, God.
Chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
So break every chain.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Hear our cry, God.
Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There are people in this room that God is speaking to,
break every
and you are not responding.
Break every chain.
You are not responding with a, yes, God, break my chains. You're responding with, oh, take it from me, God, take it from me. He gave it to you so you'd give it back to him. Are you going to be prideful and stand there? Or are you going to do what God wants you to do? Are you going to give it to him? Are you going to go to him and say, I don't know what to do. Help me. Take it from me. Take it from me, God. I give it back to you. I need you, God.
Break every chain.
Break every chain. So break every chain.
Break every chain. Break every chain.
Give it back to God. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Jesus, have your way, God, have your way, God. have your way, God. Oh. Your spirit overwhelm us, God. Let your spirit overwhelm us. Holy, holy is the Lord. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Your kingdom come, God. Your kingdom come, God. What that person did to you, it's irrelevant in the presence of God. What that you've done to those people, it is irrelevant in the presence of God. All of it is there to drive you to God. All of it is there to teach you you need a Savior, to show you, to display to you that you need God. Because your love overcame the grave, surely you could break every chain. Your love overcame the grave, surely you can break every chain. Is your love overcame the grave, surely you can break every chain. So break our chains,
break our chains.
Sing your love.
Your love overcame the grave, surely you can break
your love.
Every chain.
It's your love.
If your love overcame the grave, surely you can break every chain.
It's your love
overcame the grave,
your
surely
love.
You can break every chain. So break our chains.
Break our chains.
Break our chains.
Our pride. Our spirit of injustice. Come on, sing, people. So break our chains, break our chains,
break our chains.
So break our chains, break our chains. Your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain. Your love,
and your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain.
It's your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain. So break our chains. Break our chains. Your love overcame the grave.
Surely you can break
your love,
every chain.
Your love.
And your love overcame the grave. Surely you can break every chain.
Overcame the grave, surely you can break every chain. So break our chains,
break our chains,
break
our chains, break our chains.
We need to be in God's presence. We need to be in God's presence. No words that come out of my mouth can touch your heart like God can touch it. Can melt your soul and your spirit to humility like God can. Slow down, take time. Breathe in, he said. He'll reveal what's to come. The thoughts in his mind, always higher than mine. He'll reveal all to come. So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your as your triumph unfolds. He's never failing. He's never failing. Never failing, God. You're always there, God. Sing praise.
Sing praise, my soul. Find strength in joy. Let His words
failing. He's never failing.
Take courage.
So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your hope as your triumph unfolds.
Each by name.
Who call them each by name.
You keep your promises.
We'll surely keep
your promise to me. And I will rise in your victory.
You hold the stars.
And you hold the stars.
You call unfolds. He's never failing. He's never failing. You hold the stars.
And you who hold the stars. You call them each by name. We'll surely keep your promise to me, and I will rise in your victory.
You hold the stars.
And you hold the stars.
You call us each by name.
Who call them each by name.
Your plans will be fulfilled.
Your
Self-worth, the love of others for our value, our truth. it all leads to death. But in Christ, and in Christ alone, miracles happen when I fix my eyes on Jesus Christ. Miracles happen when I fix my eyes on Jesus Christ. So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your hope as your triumph unfolds. He's never failing. He's never failing. Submit to God, whether willfully or forcefully. Now is your moment. Now is your time. The hand of God will come upon you to either bless you or curse you. Thank you. thanks for worshiping with us this morning. I don't know what God's doing, but he's doing something, and hopefully he's doing something in your life.
Okay. Back to reality.
No.
Good morning, everybody. For anyone who is new here today, we don't pass the plate, but there is an offering box downstairs at the control desk or the front desk there. It's on the right side, so don't forget to put your tithes and offerings there. Like I said last week, we fired up the boiler, and it's hungry for gas, and it will eat up the budget, so help out there if you can. Also, if you're on church council, we have a meeting next week after the service, so keep that on your calendar, please. And from God's word this morning, two things God keeps bringing back to my mind over and over and over again. One is 2 Corinthians 3:17. He says, "The Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." He gives you freedom from the spiritual aspects of your sin so that you can run after him with everything that you have. And he also says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, he said, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, all things have become new. God wants to do a renewing work in you today. He wants to take a hold of you. It doesn't matter where you are, or what you've done, or where you've been, or what you think, or it doesn't matter anything about you. If you are in Christ, you're a new creation. Hang on to that new creation. Hang on to the one who gives you that new creation. He promises you that the old has passed away and that all things have become new. He means that for you. It doesn't matter who you are. He means it for you. So please take a hold of it. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for who you are. I thank you, Lord Jesus. You are the Lamb of God. You are worthy of all praise. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you came and died on the cross for us. That you came for redemption. That you came for forgiveness through your shed blood. I just pray, Father God, that you would allow your spirit to come and indwell each of us this morning. Help us to open our hearts up to you. Help us to receive your Holy Spirit. Help us to lay it all down and to realize and to shout out at the top of our lungs that we surrender to you. That we surrender to the healing that is ours through Christ. So Lord God, we give you all the glory, we give you all the honor, and we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. I want you to do some role playing with me this morning just for a minute. What I want you to do is I want you to play the role of a cancer patient that has terminal cancer. Your family is flying in, aunts and uncles and nieces and nephews to say goodbye, and you will be gone in 3 to 4 months, and you don't even know how long it's going to be. I want you, everyone in this room, to imagine that. Anybody ever known anybody with cancer? Imagine you being the person. Have you ever thought this in your own mind? Imagine you being that person. The only hope you have is Christ. And you're pretty sure he wants to see you in person quickly. And then Jesus walks in the room and says in a declarative voice, I have the cure. Anyone who will submit to me and live their life for me, you can have it right now. All you have to do is speak up. Remember, you're the cancer patient. How would you speak up? Jesus, I need help. Me. What if the room didn't have 70 people in it, but it had 300? How would you speak up?
Me.
Sulu, how would you speak up?
What?
Yeah, right. He'd be like, what? Maybe I didn't make it close enough for you. So let's say not only are your aunts and uncles and your nieces and nephews flying in, but let's say your 5 children are sitting there. All under the age of 12. How would you speak up? With a loud, declarative voice, I need help. Or would you go, well, as your 4-year-old turns and looks at you and says, speak up, mommy. You didn't speak up this morning. You sat there in your pride, in your hurt, in your pain. Of what's happened to you, and how hurtful and painful it was that you have cancer and you're going to die, and you couldn't stop focusing on you enough to speak up and say, I need help. I got them out of order. I thought I had them in the right order, but they're not. The Bible, and this is the message, is a paraphrase of Peter chapter 5. So be content with who you are and do not put on airs. God's strong hand is on you. He'll promote you at the right time. Live carefree and before God. He is most careful with you. He gets the last word. Keep a cool head. Stay alert. The devil is poised to pounce. And would like nothing better than to catch you napping. Keep your guard up. You're not the only ones plunged into these hard times. It's the same with Christians all over the world. So keep a firm grip on the faith. The suffering won't last forever. It won't be long before this generous God, who has great plans for us in Christ, eternal and glorious plans they are, will have you put together and on your feet for good. He will get the last word. Unless you don't focus on him. Unless you don't even know he's in the room. And why wouldn't you know he's in the room? Because you were so focused on you and your pain and your hurt and your needs and your emotions and your feelings. Miracles don't happen when you ask everybody to pray for you. Miracles happen when you fix your eyes on Jesus. There's nothing wrong with asking everybody to pray for you, unless that's your only hope. What about your faith? What about your eyes? What about your attention? What about your affection? Well, I go to church every once in a while. Anybody in this room, somebody testify about putting your affections on the wrong things and it leads you to death. Are you going to focus on Christ? It is hard. But the enemy is waiting, King James Version, seeking whom he may devour. Some of you think that crying out to the lion who's roaming the earth, seeking whom he may devour, crying out to him as he stands over you, begging him for mercy, is crying out to God. You're just going to be consumed. Your sin is going to consume you. We must discipline ourselves like grown adults to focus on what is important, not expecting everyone else around us to make us behave. Grow up. What does the Bible tell us about someone who washes back and forth, back and forth? I want to serve God, I don't want to serve God. I want to serve God, I don't want to serve God. I'm going to focus on God, I'm not going to focus on God. You should expect to receive nothing from the Lord. Nothing. But by golly, when you take prayer requests, those are the people with their hands up. I don't know if you know this, but God was here this morning. Still is, but boy, he was touching people this morning. His presence was here, as he says it will be. Were you excited, and did you submit your heart and your mind to him, and did you say, God, show me what you want me to do? Or were you spending that time searching yourself, trying to figure out if you were good enough to be in his presence? Because you're not good enough to be in his presence. That's what makes him so awesome. That's what makes it so awesome that he came down and touched you. And for you, as he's touching you, when you suck and you don't deserve it, to sit there and think about whether you deserve it or not means that your eyes are not upon him. They're upon you. And if we dug a little deeper into your mind and in your heart, we'd find out that you really are all about you. You're like, I don't think so. Set up a time with me. Let's sit down and talk. Got some questions to ask you. Let me ask you a question. When you screw up, do you question whether God's real? If you do, it's about you, not about God. It's about your righteousness and your abilities. When things go wrong in your life, do you question God at all? Even his existence? If you do, we know it's not about God, it's about you. When bad things happen and you screw up, your response should be, God, what are you trying to teach me? What are you trying to show me about myself? You ready for this? When bad things happen, do you quickly get your database out in your brain and try to find out who's to blame? Do you? What if it was your best friend and they despitefully hurt you and used you and hurt your children and everyone you love? Does it matter? Or do you just fix your eyes on Christ and ask Him what you need to do and what He's trying to teach you? What is it? You need to grow up. I'm going to dish it out to you like a man, like a grown woman who's had 6 kids and can go through anything. Come on, flex. I love people when they give me excuses. Just the fact that you started with an excuse means you don't understand. This is not my sermon. Sorry. Hey, maybe it's the batteries are dying. Yep, it is. Okay, I got it. Don't touch. In Luke chapter 15, it says, so he got up and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him and ran and embraced him, kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, quickly bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fattened calf. Kill it and let us eat and celebrate, for the son of mine was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found. And they began to celebrate. It's a wonderful story. It's a wonderful account of a wayward child doing his thing and coming to the understanding of their stupidity. And what? They came to an understanding of their stupidness and their foolishness, and they did what? They returned to humble themselves. They returned to the Lord to humble themselves. And then they were restored. How many of us want restoration because of our stupidness? How many of us don't want to be humbled? Duh. Adults do things that are hard. They humbled themselves, and then they were restored. They didn't stand firm, expecting restoration. He came expecting to remain humbled. What was his expectation? To be humbled, expecting nothing more than a life of humility. That's not how we return to God, is it? We return to God because we've been taught that God has bought us with a price, that He has paid for our sins, and we deserve to be blessed. And we come to God humbling ourselves for a moment so He will bless us. I'm here to tell you that the Father only blessed the Son and restored Him because the Father saw the heart of His Son. Sometimes I'm really good at discerning people. Sometimes I'm not. And because of that, I've realized that I'm stupid and I'm not good at it. Because when you're 50-50 when discerning people, it sucks. You know, you either got it or 100% or you don't. And it's weird, I've never met anybody that's 100% good at discerning other people. Not even my wife. She's about 85%. My wife doesn't like you. You need to wonder why. So I have these tests that I give people. Because I'm fallible. I don't know everything. You recorded that, right? Okay. And they're a test of humility. Oh, they're not outward tests like, hey, what I need you to do is go clean the bathrooms. No. Because anybody can fake cleaning the bathrooms a couple times. I don't even have a list of those tests, Sulu. I just know that God's like, you're going to test them. Be ready. And I'll be sitting there talking to him, and then God goes, right there. And I'll be like, and it's their response. I didn't say what they said. I said their response. Their response. See, the Father in this account saw and understood the response of His Son. And that was, I screwed up. Can I at least be your servant? I mean, you guys got, those of you that have kids, you know when they're lying and when they're not lying, right? You know? I mean, you know. Sometimes God even wakes you up in the middle of the night to tell you what they're doing. But try doing that with just people sitting across from you at church. It's hard to do. But boy, when God says, poke at that right there, and you poke at it, watch their response. The difference is, do they go, oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm like that? Or they go, why would you do that to me? You don't even care about what I'm going through, do you? Which one's humble? The one that's like, oh, I can't believe I'm like that. I'm really sorry. I really need help. The one that's not humble is the one that's like, really? I came for you to help. And all you do is, really? Yep, really. I think our session's done now. You can go home. I'll pray for you, brother. But my prayer won't be to solve your problem. My prayer will be that God humbles you, because that is your problem. Oh, pride is the thing we all struggle with, folks. There's not a one of us in this room that has this completely under control. That's why he tells us we're supposed to go to church, because church people drive you insane. The meanest, nastiest, especially people like Sulu, the meanest, nastiest people are in church. You want somebody to talk to and cry with and empathize with, go to a bar. You don't even have to drink, just sit there. Ooh, it's okay, Gloria, I understand it. Life's just so hard. But you chose him. God tells us to go to church so we can remain humble. You ever read the account of the Adam and Eve in the garden sinning and their curse? You will understand that the reason why women are always fighting for equality is because God told them they were going to always fight for equality. And God said, but you will have to submit. And the worst part is, the really bad part of that isn't the submission part. Did you know that? You guys realize, women, you know that, right? The bad part isn't the submission part. The bad part is you have to submit to somebody that sucks. Jerry knows this very well. The part, did you know that was God's plan? That you will fight for equality, you will fight to be in your soul, you will always fight and feel like people are putting you down, and you're always, until you find yourself in Christ. You will always strive to be equal, but you will have to submit to your husband. And the real curse is that your husband is imperfect. And the worst part about this, ladies, and you know this, is it's amazing how you see all the imperfections. All of them. And it's even worse because you're perfect in all your ways. And you have to submit to this. Don't tell me you don't think it. Don't tell me you don't think that you're right and that he's stupid. Don't tell me. I've done way too much marriage counseling for you to lie to me about that. And did you know that God, whoever your husband is an example of how prideful you are? Oh my. I'm not joking. God knew exactly who you needed to keep you humble. Yeah. See, everybody thinks Dan is just this wonderful man of God.
Oh, no.
Okay?
Oh, no.
And you're just seeing Dan in the twilight of his life. Dan was just an absolute horrendous, debauched human being. You think you've got it bad? Dan slept with her best friend when they were married.
Yep.
Some of you are like, you just busted Dan out. No, I didn't. That's on YouTube. It is. So God wants to set you free of your sin. Not pictures of it. Kay, you're such a perv. Kay's like, pictures. No, Kay. No. Jeez. I'm going to have to make you go sit back there with Joanne. Anyways. That testimony is on YouTube. Dan's not bound by that anymore. He's set free of that sin. The Bible tells you confess one to another. You know you're in bondage to your sin until you confess it. It doesn't matter how much Jesus sets you free from it. You're still in bondage to it. Anybody tell me why? Because you're afraid people are going to find out. Oh, Jesus separated you from your sin and it no longer separates you from God. But you're in bondage to it because you've chose to because of your pride, lack of humility. Now, I want to make something. I'm going to go to my next portion of my sermon, and I want to make something very clear. My sermon is not about you giving up your pride. Ladies, take a good hard look at your husband. That's what you needed to be humbled. This little girl appears like she's never been here before. She's like, dude, I'm going to be careful who I marry. You should. Get humble first. God will give you a better one. Man, if God gives you a husband to humble you, how bad can it get, Sarah? Sarah's husband's been high for 17 years. Straight. Can get really bad, can it, Sarah? You ready to be humbled yet? By the way, he can still pile it on, sweetie. Oh, he can. He's got a big dump truck. Anytime you hear in the heavens going, beep, 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 just know it's about to fall on your head. We need to be humbled. God gives us all kinds of things in our lives to humble us. How many guys have ever seen God give you all kinds of chances to humble you? And you just ignore them until the sky falls on your head, right, Brandy? I'm here to tell you that no matter how mature you get in God, you will always struggle with your sins of the flesh and, most importantly, your humility. It is such a struggle that any sign of arrogance and pride should be dealt with immediately and without reservation and boldly. Almost like someone breaking into your home and one of your children screaming. You don't care where you're at. You don't care what time of day it is. You don't care what you're dressed in. You're going to kill somebody. In the name of Jesus. You might even declare his name as you run down the hall with some other expletives. That's how pride in your life should be dealt with. Why? Because it is the lion roaming, seeking whom he may devour. Pride gets you to look away from God and look upon yourself and other things in your life for value and purpose. As you grow in the Lord, pride will declare itself differently. No longer does Dan want to sleep with Diane's best friend because she got rid of all of her friends. I'm just joking. Yes, she did. She don't trust any of them. Dan has a relationship with Jesus Christ. He submitted himself to God. But Dan, do you struggle with pride still? It comes out in different ways. And even if your life is 99% free of sin, more like 91%. Even if your life is 91%, because I don't know if I've ever met anybody that's in the 90s very long. Even if your life is almost free of all the sins, except maybe that little thorn in your flesh you struggle with every once in a while. Pride, and you are so focused on what God is doing in your life, and you are 110% committed to Christ and his call and his purpose and his plan. Pride will still rob you of what God has for you. It is and must be dealt with boldly, without reservation. How does pride come out in the life of someone who has committed their life to Christ completely? How about when you hear somebody struggling, you don't even say it out loud because you're a good Christian, but you think to yourself, wow, what kind of person would do that? That's pride. A person just like you, idiot. Pride will come at you and rob you of things like God tells you to do something, and you just kick the stones around you at your feet, and you look down like this and because you're afraid of what people are going to think of you. Because you're afraid of how it might affect your quality of life. That's pride. It will rob you of everything God has for you. I get a kick out of these preachers on TV that talk about being blessed and God wants you to be blessed and God wants you to live your best life they never talk long about the real thing that robs us of our blessings. Guys, it's easy to think that God is in heaven and he cares about you. It's easy to think that God is in heaven and he wants you to have a good life. It's easy because he does. It's easy to talk about and dwell upon the fact that God wants to bless you, because he does. And if that's all we needed to do is stay focused on how God's going to bless us and how he loves us, this world would be blessed. It's so funny, though, in the last 15 years to 20 years, the more the church talks about being blessed, the less blessed they are. Have you noticed, Kay? Now, you would think a church that's focused on being blessed and focused on positioning themselves rightly before the Lord to be blessed, you would think that they would be blessed and their lives would change and they would change the world. And this is such a simple formula. Know who you are in Christ and God, that God loves you and He cares about you and He wants to bless you and keep you and prosper you. You would think that those, if that was the formula, our nation wouldn't be ready to persecute Christians. But we are at the door of Christians being persecuted for their beliefs. No, it's from within. How could we be there if we're so blessed, if we've got this formula? Because it's really easy to sell that formula to prideful people who think God is about them. Think about it. God's not about you. Folks, God's going to bless you, and then He's going to ask you to give the blessing back. Not because of anything you've done, but just because He asked you. If it's about being blessed, what will you do? But God, why? Why? Like Dan says, God blesses you, you eat it, and when God asks you to give it back, you go, give back what? I already ate it. God wants us to absolutely be at war with our pride. It should never stop. Well, Pastor Mark, God doesn't want us to sit around focused on being humble. No. He wants you to focus on Him. But when you're at war and you're with your commanding officer, you're focused on the commanding officer. But if someone sneaks in the room, that's the enemy, what do you quickly do? Destroy him. Now, we don't destroy our pride. We ask people to pray with us about it. Could you imagine being in a conference room with your commanding officer and there's two or three other people in there with you and somebody walks in dressed in the other army's uniform and holds a gun to your commanding officer and all the other people in there with you go, guys, I think we need to pray. Guys, you have guns on your shoulder, on your hips for a reason. Shoot the man. Well, one of us might get hurt. Yeah, you're supposed to be saving the commanding officer, not yourself. Well, I didn't run, I just ducked underneath the table. You're going to get dishonorably discharged. Did you know that? If you survive, you're going to get... Why? Because your job was to protect your commanding officer, not yourself. Well, who would do that? Right, we're so selfish and prideful, we don't even understand it. You should be at all hands-on-deck battle with your pride. Every time it comes into your life, every time it rears its ugly head, you should have people around you going, oh, I think that's pride, dude. I think that's pride. You know, when I say I give people this little test, I'll just be standing there and God will be like, see, that's pride. Poke at it. And I'll be like,
And their response tells me if they're humble. I think we need new batteries. Pride will keep you from advancing God's kingdom. Pride will keep you in bondage until things come out the way you think they should. Do you hear that? Sarah, what if I said to you that God is going to use you this afternoon to bring somebody to the knowledge of Christ because of something you share with them today? The first thing that's going to cross your mind is, I'm not even sure I'm sold on Christ. And it's irrelevant. God has something for every one of you. Why don't most of us do it? Because we're too self-focused. We're not humble. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Most of us don't even light our light. Can I tell you why most of you don't light your light and step out and do something for God? Because you're afraid He's going to ask you for something you don't want to give up. Because you're afraid He's going to say, I want you to do this. And you're going to be like, but, I don't want to do that. I had plans. So we just I love you, Jesus. He says, I had this, I actually didn't have this argument with the person. I heard their argument, and I've been debating with them in my mind and heart for about 7 years. I'll share the debate with you. This person said, you know, churches that just want people to get involved. You know, involvement in what God is doing does not mean anything about your relationship with God. And you don't have to get involved in the church or all of that stuff in order to have a relationship with God. They're just trying to grow the church and get people involved and get them excited. And they're just trying to manipulate people emotionally to get them to feel engaged and committed to the church. And you don't have to do that. And you don't need to know who said it, because I've never said anything to him about it. I actually just rolled my eyes and walked away. You'll be proud of me, some of you in the room. Because they, you know, it's a fool who argues with a fool kind of thing, you know. And it was like, everybody has a right to be wrong. I want you to look at the end of this verse in verse 16. It says, let your light shine before men in such a way that they will see what? How will they see Christ? Through your good works. I have went to churches that thought people were going to see Christ because they prayed hard. And they never saw Christ. They didn't ever see groups of people come into their church and be ministered to and set free. They never experienced, but they prayed a lot. It's from our good works. How many of you want to have a relationship with Christ but not have to work? Well, I get up every Sunday morning. Do you know how hard it is to get up on Sunday morning and come to church? That is work all by itself, Pastor Mike. I have four kids. Do you know how hard it is to get four kids up on Sunday morning and get them ready and get to church on Sunday morning? Folks, I have to leave my house at 7 in the morning. I have to get my five children up at 6:30 and get them in the van. If you ever wonder why sometimes my kids look like a truck ran over them, it's because it almost did. I just thank God my neighbors are Chris Workman, who's getting his family up at 6:30 in the morning to come here on Sunday morning. His four kids. And we're all honking our horns trying to get our kids out of the house. Come on! We're going to be late! And I don't consider that work. Coming to church on Sunday morning is a wonderful opportunity. Work is when I give everything I've got to get nothing in return. Boy, when you start talking about that to a church filled with people who are looking to be blessed, they get up and walk out of the room. Listen. Isn't serving God great? You get to give of yourself 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and all they're going to do is poop on you. The people you give to are just going to poop on you. And if they don't poop on you, they'll let you hold their poopy rags. At least they'll ask you to clean it up when they're done. And that's awesome. Because you're never looking for the handout. You're never looking for the reward. And when you do it like that, it changes lives. And there's no formula to it. It's got to be legitimate. See, guys, my first part of my sermon was on pride and lack of humility. Because no matter where you're at in your relationship with God, whether you've just given your life to Christ a year or two ago and you're trying to struggle with overcoming the habitual sins that you started when you were in sin, living for sin, and you're struggling with that, and you're struggling with this whole commitment thing to something other than yourself, whatever it is, or you've been pastoring and ministering for 25 to 30 years, pride will be at the door. And it might not rob you of your ministry, it might just rob you of your opportunity. What? We sat here in a building that was miraculously given to us. There's only two or three churches in this community that don't wish they had this building. I can name them. Dayspring, Church of the Nazarene, maybe the Christian Center. You know, if you listen to my sermon, I would expect after service that I would be overwhelmed with people who are looking for the opportunity to do good works. But I probably won't be. Because as I sat here and I talked to you about doing what God wants you to do, the enemy's in the other ear going, but you're like this and you're like that. And he doesn't even know what kind of person you are. He doesn't know how horrible you are. If he knew, he wouldn't want you doing anything in the church. First of all, you have no clue how much of a cesspool my mind is. That whole Bible verse, take every thought captive and submit it to the knowledge of God, it's a full-time job. I have my wife pray over me as I sleep. This Bible verse, man. You are the salt of the earth. Doesn't that excite you? Yes, Pastor Mike, pass out some salt so we can throw it everywhere. But, see, Christ goes on and tells us what that salt looks like. And that salt looks like people doing the works of God, showing the good works of God to the lost and the community so that they can see the power of God. Every denomination, every organization that has done this has grown and then slowly lost their focus. Every organization, every church, every group of people that have submitted their lives to Christ and committed themselves to doing the good works in the body of Christ and in the community. God has raised them up and he has blessed them and he had used them to show his light into the world. And then they lost their vision. Do you know how many people come into this building and they just go, yeah, we go out to the Y. I never understood why they left downtown. Their vision changed from being a young Christian men's association to a community health club. We purposely left a thing on the downstairs in the community room. Anybody know what it says? There's a saying that was painted on that room probably in the 60s. Anybody know what it says? Yes. Their old mission statement. It's about sharing Christ. God raised that organization up to a worldwide organization. And then they lost their vision. And why did they lose their vision? Because they began to get prideful. What would other people think of us? It's deep in every decision we make. Listen, if you can't get control of it being a drug addict, if you can't get control of it being a sex fiend, if you can't get control of it just being a selfish jerk. Yeah, I looked at you and I said it. Anyways, I'm just messing with you, Russell. If you can't get control of that now, there's no way you can be used of God to do great things and be in control of your pride. There is no way. No way. No, it's impossible. Think about it. The YMCA. God uses them to do great and mighty things. The buildings all over the nation. Like this. And then they started worrying about what people thought of them. You know how many times God robs me? I rob myself of what God has for me. Because I'm worried about what people think of me. I'm worried about making a mistake. How many of you have ever been led of God to pray for somebody to be healed? And they were in the room with you. And you didn't go lay hands on them and pray for them. And why didn't you? Because you were afraid they weren't going to be healed. And what would they think of you? Oh, look, there it is. Some of you weren't even afraid of that. You were just afraid of what they'd think of you by walking over and asking them to pray for them. I hear this argument all the time. It's really funny because people who know me know that this argument is the dumbest argument in the face of history. Pastor Mike, there's all kinds of things I'd like to do at the church. But you know, you're a control freak. And you know, let me just say something. You're misunderstanding. Could it be that I have discerned your heart? Would you like me to tell you? Or would you like me just to smile at you? That's a little creepy, isn't it? How many of you guys know that when I know that your heart is right, I give you a ministry and say, let me know if you need anything. I don't even check in on you. And you feel like you're all alone and Pastor Mike doesn't even care, don't you? Some of you do, trust me. And it's true because I don't even think about you. Somebody said to me the other day, they're like, you let your wife run the children's ministry. You don't even know what's going on back there. I was like, my wife's running the children's? Oh, yeah, she is. Because I know that God raises up people to do things and he doesn't need me to be involved. And if I'm the oversight for that ministry, if there's a problem, God will tell me about it, or hopefully the person will tell me. God can use you just like he can use me. So let me take your excuse away. I just took that one, first one away. I'm not a control freak. Just because maybe I don't have your vision and I don't think that vision fits does not mean I'm a control freak. Maybe it means God gave you a vision and now's not the time and you're not mature enough to know it. I remember Gaither coming to me about a year and a half ago. And we had stumbled across a ministry, a national kind of ministry, sort of a grassroots ministry. And he was like, I want to do this. And I looked at him like he had five heads. Because I was just like, dude, that is totally not what God is doing. And I even prayed about it because I was just as enthusiastic and excited about what he was talking about as he was. But I knew it wasn't what God was doing right now. He doesn't even know that I've already created the space for that to happen in this building. Because now's the time. Now imagine if Gaither got butt hurt about it. Did you? Did you get butt hurt? Okay, let's, okay. Nikki, did you get butt hurt? Just a little bit. Okay. Imagine if he got butthurt about it. He got frustrated and he's like, Pastor Mike doesn't understand what God has called me to do. Anybody laughing about this because you've heard people say this?
Oh, yeah.
He doesn't even care. Have no clue. Taylor, you sat in my house on 229 Thew Avenue. And we used to talk about this church before it existed. And the vision of this church was a place where God could bring people and they could become whatever God called them to become. And if they couldn't sing, but they felt like God called them to sing, then they could sing. Right, Chanel? We're Chanel. Some of you get ministry because she loves Jesus, man. She loves worshiping God. We have to turn her mic down because sometimes she just doesn't know she can't sing. It's okay. Because guess what, Chanel? You blessing people out here. They see you going, and now that you know she really can't sing, you're like, wow. I want faith like that. And I joke about this because there was a kid and I used to have his youth ministry. His name was Scott Myers. And Scott couldn't sing at all. I mean, he's horrible. Chanel, you are 10 times better than he is. Or was, okay? And he wanted to sing for Jesus. And this was early in my ministry, so I was arrogant more than I am today. And I was like, no way, my God, that man can't sing. I was a worship leader. He was like 16. Maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, it might have been longer than that, 10 years ago, I heard that he was leading worship at the church, and it was awesome and anointed. What? I want you to think about that. He had a vision of what God was going to do in his life. And he just kept doing the good works. And he kept singing for Jesus no matter what. So what if now's not the time? Share what God is telling you to do. When the time comes, it'll happen.
Well, I'm afraid to talk to you about it, Pastor Mike, because...
Listen, don't be afraid to talk to me about it. But be afraid if you start something and don't finish it. Because you will be confronted. I'm going to send Richard to confront you. So Richard is that classic guy. He'll look at you and go, all the while he's like, love you, buddy. Or I'll send Tom Moore.
Didn't you tell us that you were going to do this? And you're not doing it. Could you explain yourself? So what that means about you is that you can't be trusted, right? What do you think you should do about that? Am I doing good at it?
Oh, yeah. Right on.
Tom's my heavy. Like, Mike, is there anything I can do for you? Yes. Go get them. I will pray for them. You know that whole thing about pride? Why don't you focus on that first? When your wife says you're humble, maybe we'll give you a microphone. Angie, Debbie, you're welcome. Guys, your pride not only keeps you in your sin, but once you mature past all of that stupid stuff, it'll keep you from experiencing God. Anybody testify to that? Don't shake your head. They can't see that. Anybody testify to that? Yeah. We are supposed to be the light. If God gave us this spot, how big of a light is this supposed to be? Shouldn't you get busy? So I got some things I need some people to help me do. You're like, are you wanting us to commit now? Yeah. I'm going to name names. Really?
Yeah.
The children's ministry has been given a vision from the Lord about a year or more ago. Oh, no, it was about 8 years ago. When he gave us this facility, we knew what he wanted us to do. We have laid the groundwork. And I mean, what we're going to do is not easy. There has to be a system in place that is consistent with people that can be trusted to be there consistently. Very similar to the system we have with our youth programs. We have that today. We have the facilities. Now we need people to be committed. This is what I need. I need people who are willing to go pick up children to be here at 10:30. If we want to make it 9, that's fine, but I don't know how many of you will get up early enough to go pick up kids to be here at 9. I need people to be here to feed them every Sunday morning. You're like, ooh, yeah. You be here every Sunday morning at 7 o'clock making breakfast for them. Pastor Mike, we can hardly pay the bills. How are we going to pay for that? It's not my responsibility to pay that. It's my responsibility to do what God told us to do. Well, who's going to pay the bills? I don't know. It's not my job. This isn't the first time I was this stupid. Is it, Jim? We need, now listen to this, folks. This will blow your mind. We need someone to coordinate a program in the community to raise the money to buy vehicles to do this. These will be used for more than just the children's programs. They'll be used for the youth outreach programs. They can be used in the afternoons to pick kids up from school, to bring them to the youth outreach program after school. You're like, what are you doing, Pastor Mike? I'm pushing you to fulfill the vision that God has for us. I am aware that some of you will rebel in arrogance and you will run. Love you. You'll be back. We need people to help out in the children's ministry classes. Our goal, how many guys have been to the children's auditorium? How many children do you think you can fit in there standing up? Wilson says 200. Okay, how many vans is it going to take to pick up 200 kids on Sunday morning? 20. How are we going to do that, Pastor Mike? I don't know, that's what we're supposed to do. I want it to be so crazy up here that when 150, 200 people are meeting in here, worshiping, that there's 100 to 200 kids back there doing their thing, and we've got so many people in this building that we can't all meet in this room. I don't want that to happen because I want to feel like I pastored a big church. Folks, I'm about to die because I'm so busy. How busy will I be with 200 people coming to church on Sunday morning? The pay ain't going to get any better. That's what God's called us to do. Clay Sports, the only church in the community that signed anybody up was ours. Do you know why? Because he went to the churches. He had churches look at him and say, why are you doing this? We have our own programs. Why would anyone want to do that? His goal wasn't to do a church program. It was to do an outreach program. But nobody wants to do an outreach program. He came to me and he said, I don't know what you want to do. I said, just let us do it. He says, what do you mean? I said, next year we'll take it and we'll just go sign up a bunch of kids in the community and we'll do the PR. And he looked at me and he smiled and he said, why wait till next year? Season doesn't start till January. And I said, okay, well then we'll do it. I just committed you to do it. Because I ain't got no more time. Unless you want to spend all your time praying for me that God gives me more time to do it. But it would be a lot easier if you'd just do it. Stop praying for me and get involved. Well, you can keep praying, but just get involved, man. You wouldn't have so much to pray about. And by the way, you can pray while you're doing it. Somebody this week and last week have discovered the joy of ministering with just being there. And they were like, you don't even have to do anything. You just show up and then God does stuff. Yeah! Isn't that amazing?